And now, please welcome to the stage, Rose Watts, Recruitment and Personnel Manager from our closing keynote sponsor, Questmark.
Good morning and happy Friday. Our company has an informal motto. While roofing and flooring is our business, giving back to our community is our commitment. We also seek to help the least, the last, and the lost. We live out this motto both through our charitable giving as well as in the ways we recruit and retain employees. And it is these values that bring me here today. More than a year ago, I spoke with CentiMark's good friend and partner, Sister Linda Yankowski, at Holy Family Institute about our desire to work with the communities in which we operate to find new employees. Unlike many companies, we are not looking for the perfect past work experience. Rather, we are looking for people who have the desire to work hard, who want to grow with a company and earn a living to support their families. Our company values organic growth in promoting employees from within. For example, our Executive Vice President and Director of Questmark, John Scanlon, started with the company as a roofing laborer. Across the country, this kind of career growth is a common occurrence. I myself made the transition from a career in the nonprofit sector to corporate America to help Questmark connect the dots between recruitment and community. My passion is to give individuals a chance to prove their work ethic and loyalty based on what they can do right now. At Questmark, we are working on innovations and approaches to ensure employment opportunities are accessible to people and that the company itself serves as a pipeline for entry, advancement, and economic mobility. Our biggest asset is our employees. And with this being top of mind, we have created new programs to help motivate and retain them. One such example is our field certification program. That allows entry-level and experienced employees to take control of their career path. We provide them with the knowledge and the tools they need to get to the next level, as well as the wage range they will be paid when they get there. We are also looking to remove barriers and recruit employees through the people and communities they trust. Since Sister Linda introduced us to your Alliance Network, we have been working together on a new partnership, and I'm happy to tell you that Questmark will be working with Alliance member organizations in key cities around the country to develop employment pipelines at the local level, providing direct connections to employment for the people you work with on a daily basis. We are starting with a handful of partners, including neighborhood centers in Houston and Auberly in Pittsburgh. Over time, we have the potential to grow this partnership to reach all 85 offices across the country. Partnering with the Alliance just makes sense to us. We are very excited about our new partnership, and we are happy to support the great work all of you do. Questmark is happy to provide a second chance to community members looking for a transition or a new opportunity to prove who they are and what they are worth. That's why I am honored to introduce our closing speaker, an individual who has built a thriving organization and international reputation based on second chances. Father Gregory Boyle is the founder and executive director of Homeboy Industries in Los Angeles, now the largest gang intervention, rehabilitation, and reentry program in the world. Homeboy employs and trains former gang members in a range of social enterprises and provides critical services to 15,000 people who walk through its doors every year seeking a better life. Father Boyle is the author of the 2010 New York Times bestseller, Tattoos on the Heart, The Power of Boundless Compassion. He is the subject of Academy Award winner Frieda Lee Mock's 2012 documentary G-Dog. He has received the California Peace Prize and has been inducted into the California Hall of Fame. In 2014, the White House named Father Boyle a champion of change, and just this year received the Humanitarian of the Year Award from the National Culinary Arts Organization, the James Beard Foundation. Ladies and gentlemen, it is a real honor for me to introduce Father Greg Boyle.
Thank you very much. It's a real privilege to be with you as you close out your days here. what Martin Luther King says about church could well be said of your time here these days. It's not the place you come to, it's the place you go from. And so you go from here with a renewed spirit, I presume, and with a refined mission. It's the privilege of my life for the last 30 years to have worked with gang members, and I'm privileged to have members of my community at Homeboy Industries here with me, Reuben, David, and Nikki. And there you go. And it's the privilege of having my heart altered and the own course of my own life redirected because of the thousands and thousands of men and women I've been privileged to know. People like Louis Bettis, who runs the place along with a handful of other homies who runs the place while I'm not there. And that's nice. You know, he's a homie, was a prison, shot caller, tattooed, was a heroin addict for a time. And now he's the personnel director at Homeboy Industries, so he, you know, is quite helpful there, leadership role. He also speaks a fair amount, and he likes public speaking, you know. And we went out to dinner not long ago, and he was giving me tips on how to speak publicly. He said, you know, you got to pepper your talk with self-defecating humor. I said, yeah, no shit. That is some good advice there. So brace yourselves. Well, this is not the place you've come to, it's the place you go from, and you leave here with a vision, you know, and you have to refine your vision, you know, because otherwise it gets garbled and confusing. And it's not for nothing that people have mission statements and vision statements, and you need to know what it is, because that's your engine, you know. The prophet Habakkuk writes, the vision still has its time, presses on to fulfillment, and it will not disappoint. And if it delays, wait for it. But my sense of you folks right now is that you don't want to wait for too long, con los brazos cruzados, you know, tapping your feet, staring at your watches, you know. All of us want to make something happen. What is the thing we want to make happen? Mother Teresa, I think, diagnosed the world's ills correctly when she suggested that the problem in the world is that we've just forgotten that we belong to each other. So how do we stand against forgetting that? How do we imagine a circle of compassion and then imagine nobody standing outside that circle? How do we choose together to dismantle the barriers that exclude? How do we create a community of kinship such that God, in fact, might recognize it? And so we stand at the margins with the poor and the powerless and the voiceless. We stand with those whose dignity has been denied and those whose burdens are more than they can bear. And everyone in this room has had that particular exquisite privilege to be able to stand even with the easily despised and the readily left out, with the demonized so that the demonizing will stop, and with the disposable so that the day will come when we stop throwing people away. In fact, if kinship happened to be our goal, we would no longer be promoting justice. We would be celebrating it. Because the truth of the matter is, all the singular and worthy goals that we have ahead of us, peace, justice, equity, equality, are all byproducts of our kinship. For no kinship, no peace. No kinship, no justice. No kinship, no equality. No kinship, no equity. They actually can't happen unless there's this undergirding sense that we belong to each other, that we are connected, which is exceedingly important. You know, even in our service, it's careful for us and important for us to note that there's sometimes distance that separates us, and we want to bridge even that distance. You know, service provider, service recipient. We want there to be no daylight, really, that separates us. We want to arrive at that exquisite mutuality, which is a hallmark of our kinship with each other, of our connection with each other. Service is good, and you want to encourage people to begin there, but that's where you begin. You don't want to settle for only service, because service is the hallway that gets you to the ballroom, which is the place of kinship and connection. One of the great privileges of my life was knowing Cesar Chavez as a friend. And, one of the most things that I remember about him was that he was the best listener I've ever been in the presence of. If you were talking to Cesar Chavez, nobody else existed. It was laser beam focused. He was never looking over your shoulder to see if someone more famous was on the approach. But quite famously, once a reporter had commented to him and said, "Wow, these farm workers, they sure love you." And Cesar just shrugged and smiled and said, "The feeling's mutual." Which, of course, is our goal. How do we arrive at this place where there is no us and them, there's just us, and the feeling is mutual? Even that distance of between service provider, service recipient is bridged. A no homie found more job opportunities through Homeboy Industries than a guy everybody called Dreamer. I knew him when he was a little mococito growing up in the housing projects. He got into a gang. Super smart kid, though I don't remember school ever played much of a role. Very dangerous sense of humor, which I've always enjoyed, even to this day. He's in his 40s now, but in his 20s, he was kind of a yo-yo, in and out of being locked up. He'd come to me, I'd find him a job in the private sector or in one of our social enterprises at Homeboy Industries, but he would always gravitate back to vague criminality, usually something involving drugs, you know, the sale of or the use of. And then he'd wander back to me. So this was a pattern that kept repeating itself. So this one time he finished a 4-month stretch probation violation at county jail, and there he is sitting in front of my desk. And he says what gang members often say, "This time it'll be different." And I go, okay. So with him sitting there, I pick up the phone, I call a friend of mine named Gary, who runs a vending machine company in Alhambra, California. And Gary had hired homies in the past, so I'm thinking, I don't know, hoping against hope, maybe he'll do it again. And sure enough, he says, "You tell him he can start tomorrow." That's a holy man right there. So Dreamer began work the next day at the vending machine company. Well, 2 weeks later, there he is again in front of my desk. And I go, "Híjole madre santa, I can't even believe this is happening." But he pulls out of his pocket his very first paycheck, and he waves it proudly, and he goes, "Damn, G, this paycheck makes me feel proper. I mean, my mom, she's proud of me, and my kids, they're not ashamed of me. And you know who I have to thank for this job." And I said, "Well, gosh, who?" And he looked at me strangely and he said, "Well, God, of course." "Oh, yeah, no." "That's right, that would be God, yeah." And he goes, "You thought I was going to say you." I said, "No, gosh, God's number one, yeah." He said, "You are so lucky. We're not living in them Genesis days." And I said, "What do you mean, them Genesis days?" "Well, because God would have been had struck down your ass already by now." Well, we just died laughing. And the thing I most recall was that we dissolved into laughter. We fell out of our chairs. And I defy you to identify exactly who's the service provider, who's the service recipient. It's mutual. We're called to create a community of kinship. That's the goal. If that is our focus, then watch everything else fall into place. So for 30 years, the homies have taught me everything of value, and in the last few years, they've taught me how to text, and I'm so grateful to them, because I find it sure beats the heck out of actually talking to people. And I'm pretty good at it. I'm very dexterous, you know, LOL and OMG and BTW, and the homies have taught me a new one, OHN, which apparently stands for, oh, hell no. And I've been using that one quite a bit lately. I know I can't be alone in being vexed by this autocorrect thing. Oh my God. You know, I had a homegirl not long ago named Bertha on a Sunday. She texted me, where are you at? I said, I'm about to speak to a room full of monjas. And monjas is Spanish for nuns, sisters, religious women. I'm about to speak to a room full of monjas. I pushed send. Autocorrect told her I was about to speak to a room full of ninjas, which she thought, you know, was pretty darn interesting. The worst one, right now I was sitting here and I just have 1,000 text messages from homies with their hair on fire, and it's like, I needed this, and they're cutting off my that, and my payment on that is due. And so a homie with his hair on fire needed just a certain amount of money to finish off his rent, and I just didn't have it. So I wrote, things are tight, and I pushed send. Autocorrect told him, thongs are tight. And he wrote back, sorry to hear that. You know, what about my rent, you know? So anyway, there I am in a car with two homies, Manuel and Poncho, and they're older vatos who do a variety of things at Homeboy, and we're gonna go give a talk in Palm Desert at a high school, and they're gonna help me give the talk. So we meet at 9 and at our headquarters in Chinatown, and we just finished our morning meeting as we do every morning, and then we're in the car going. Manuel's in the front seat. And 15 minutes, we're on the road, and he gets an incoming text, and he chuckles to himself. And I said, well, what is it? And he goes, oh, it's dumb. It's from Snoopy back at the office. Well, I just seen Snoopy. Snoopy gave me a big abrazo as the day was beginning. Snoopy and Manuel work together in the clock-in room where they clock in hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of gang members who work there. And I would not want this job. I mean, because this may come as a surprise, gang members can occasionally be attitudinal. So I go, well, what's he say? And he goes, oh, hang on, it's really dumb. Hey, dog, it's me, Snoops. Yeah, they got my ass locked up at county jail. They're charging me with being the ugliest vato in America. You have to come down right now, show them they got the wrong guy. Well, I nearly drove into oncoming traffic, you know. We just howled with laughter. And then I realized that Manuel and Snoopy are enemies. They're from rival gangs. They used to shoot bullets at each other. Now they shoot text messages. And there's a word for that, and the word is kinship. How do we obliterate once and for all the illusion that we are separate? So Homeboy Industries was born in 1988 when I was pastor of the poorest parish in the city of Los Angeles, Dolores Mission. I arrived in 1986. The parish was comprised of two public housing projects, Pico Gardens and Aliso Village. At the time, it was the largest grouping of public housing west of the Mississippi. We had 8 gangs at war with each other, which is not typical at all. A lot of you have experience with housing developments that it's not typical to have 8 gangs at war with each other, making it, according to the LAPD, the place of the highest concentration of gang activity in all of Los Angeles. So if LA was the gang capital of the world, my parish was the gang capital of Los Angeles. Keep in mind there are 1,100 gangs in LA County, according to the Sheriff's Department, and 120,000 gang members. So I buried my first young person killed because of this sadness in 1988, and I buried my 216th yesterday. A young man named Russell McNeil, who a number of years ago worked at Homeboy, a sweetheart. Not all of those 216 were from that parish, of course, but I run a really large gang intervention program, so I get asked to do this. So the first thing we did was we started a school. You try to listen, you know, and receive. And people, the poor will tell you, the folks on the margins will tell you what they need. And so we started a school because there were so many middle school, junior high age gang members who had been given the boot from their home school. Nobody wanted them. So they were, during the day, wreaking havoc. They were writing on the walls, selling drugs. They were violent. So I walked out to them in the projects, and I would kind of corner them and isolate them and say, hey, you know, if I found a school that would take you, would you go? And to my surprise, every single one said, yeah, I would. And then I couldn't find a school that would take them, you know, so I kind of forced my hand. So right across the street from the church is our parochial school, elementary school, grades K to 8. First two floors are the school, but the entire third floor was the convent where the ninjas lived. So I gathered all the nuns together in the living room, and I said, hey, you know, would you guys mind, you know, moving out, and we could turn the convent into, you know, a school for gang members. And they went, sure. Really, that was their discernment. Sure. And it was, then we did. And that brought gang members to the church, not to church services, of course, but to our property, which created for the parishioners kind of a disconnect. Okay, wait a minute. Let me see if I got this right. Aren't churches supposed to be hermetically sealed? Good people in, bad people out. What's going on here? So that was a good, I would call it a gospel challenge. And then gang members in very large numbers came, and it was a tough school, trust me. I had a principal once who lasted exactly one day. We would have teachers last a couple more days beyond that, but fights all the time. It was really something, but it worked. And then they said, you know, if only we had jobs. So myself and the women in the parish, we marched around the housing projects at the factories that surrounded the housing projects, trying to find felony-friendly employers, and that wasn't so forthcoming. So we invented things. We had crews, you know, a graffiti removal crew, landscaping crew, maintenance crew. We had a crew to build a child care center. And then in 1992, there was the unrest in the city after the Rodney King beating verdict, and the whole city exploded. But the poorest parish in the community and section of the community didn't explode. So the LA Times was kind of curious. So they came and inquired, and they asked me. So I told them, well, I think it's because we have 60 strategically hired enemy rival gang members working side by side with each other. So consequently, they have a reason to get up in the morning, and more importantly, a reason not to ignite the community the night before or to gangbang. So the next day, a movie producer named Ray Stark, who happened to have $500 million, summoned me to his office in Beverly Hills. And so, you know, I said, yeah, why, break bread, as we would say, you know, kick us down with some money. And he says, well, what would you do with, what would you like? And I said, well, you could buy this bakery across the street from the church, catty corner from the church, and it's abandoned, but it has ovens. You know, we could put hairnets on rival enemy gang members. They could bake bread. We could call it Homeboy Bakery. That was the extent of my entire business plan. And he said, sure. So we were off and running, you know, and we began. And then a month later, we started Homeboy Tortillas in the Grand Central Market in downtown LA. Once we had plural, we changed our name from Jobs for Our Future to Homeboy Industries, as if there was any industry involved in this. And not every business venture worked. I'll be the first to admit it. Homeboy Plumbing really was not hugely successful. I mean, who knew? People didn't want gang members in their homes. I did not see that coming. And nobody ever intends to do such a thing, but you back yourself into things. You evolve, you know, and so we backed our way. Now we are the largest gang intervention rehab reentry program on our planet. So 15,000 folks a year walk through our doors trying to reimagine their lives and somehow redirect them. The centerpiece, of course, is our 18-month training program. So the homies want in on that because it's a paid gig. And part of once you're in that 18-month program, all these services are at your disposal. Case management, we have all these curricular offerings, anger management, grief and loss, parenting. We still have a school GED program, AA, NA, and even CGA, which is Criminals and Gangs Anonymous. This is Friday, so we just had Baby and Me, which was at 9:15, so the homies and homegirls bring their toddlers. And it's kind of a pandemonium, you know. There's this homies packing the place, and they're on the floor playing with their kids, and there's watercolors and clay and food, and they sing all the time. And they have a big multicolored parachute in the middle of the floor, and they put a kid in the middle, and they do that, you know, and which can't be safe. But once we had a homie named, everybody called him Big Mike. He was a huge guy, a couple days out of Tehachapi prison, and he wanders into the class, and he sees all the dancing and the singing and the clay and the homies on the floor playing with their toddlers, and he goes to Teresa, one of our counseling staff, "Can I sign up for this class?" And she goes, "Sure," and she starts to take his name. "Do you have to have a kid to be in it?" he says, you know, which is kind of sort of the whole idea, you know. But I always remember that because there's no doubt in my mind that Big Mike once was a child. But I have serious doubts if he ever, in fact, had a childhood. So at Homeboy, they can reclaim things long denied them. Then we have free tattoo removal. No place on the planet removes more tattoos than we do. We have a designated clinic, tattoo removal mostly all day long, 9 to 5, Monday through Friday. We have one paid physician assistant and 47 volunteer doctors who donate their time. I don't know how many thousands of tattoos treatments we give, but if any of you are starting to regret that Alliance tattoo you have, see me afterwards. No questions asked. And again, you're trying to listen, you know, because there are two stances when it comes to standing at the margins. There's humility or hubris, you know. Humility says, "Hey, what would help?" And hubris says, "Here's what your problem is." So if you can anchor yourself in humility, you listen and people will tell you exactly what they need. So tattoo removal was born because a guy came into my office, a guy named Frank, 2 days out of Corcoran State Prison, and he's sitting in front of my desk. And I'd never met him, I didn't know him, and tattooed on his forehead, filling the whole space like a damn billboard, and pardon my French, it says, "Fuck the world." Fills the whole thing. And he looks at me and he says, "You know, I am having a hard time finding a job." And I said, well Frank, maybe we could put our heads together on this, you know. And I'm thinking, what job can I send him to? You know, to McDonald's? You know, do you want fries with that? No, I don't have any. Mothers clutching their kids running out of the store. So naturally, I hired him. And so he bagged bread for almost 2 years. And I went looking for a dermatologist with a laser machine. And I found one at White Memorial Hospital. And he donated 1 hour a month to chip away at Frank's forehead and a few others. And before too long, I had a waiting list of 3,000 homies who wanted the same service. So if you listen, folks will tell you what it is they want and what they need. Parentheses, Frank is currently a security guard at a movie studio in Hollywood, and there is no trace left of the dumbest, angriest thing he had ever done in his life, proving once and for all what Sister Helen Prejean says is quite right. Everyone is a whole lot more than the worst things they've ever done. So we have a therapy. We have 5 paid therapists, 42 volunteer therapists, including 2 psychiatrists who prescribe meds as needed. But everybody's in therapy. And I'm happy to say that in my first 10 years of doing this, there was a huge stigma connected to it. I'm not crazy, and what are you trying to say? And, you know, and now everybody's in therapy. It's not a big deal. And the turning point, and this may seem strange, was that that movie Analyze This. I picked up a homie at an emergency room. He had called me. He was having an anxiety attack. He had never had that before. And I said, you know, it might help if you talk to somebody. Oh, you mean like Analyze This? And I said, yeah, Analyze This. And pretty soon I heard that many, many times subsequently. And now there's just kind of no stigma, which is nice and extremely helpful for folks to do the work and unearth things and excavate wounds. And then we have all our training programs, solar panel installation training program. A Homeboy Bakery is thriving. Homeboy Silkscreen, been around for 22 years. Homeboy Homegirl Merchandise, where we sell our logo stuff. Homeboy Grocery, which is from San Luis Obispo to San Diego. We sell chips and salsas and guacamole in all the Ralph's supermarkets, which is a Kroger thing. And Homeboy Diner at City Hall, the only place you can get food. We have a restaurant at American Airlines Terminal 4 at LAX. We have farmers markets of 35 or so venues where we sell our wares. What am I missing? Homegirl Cafe, where women with records, young ladies from rival gangs, waitresses with attitude will gladly take your order. It's kind of a who's who. If you've never been there, you should go there because you'll run into people. There are always elected officials there, people who want to be seen there. And there are the celebrities, you know, Jim Carrey. It's always pandemonium when he shows up for lunch there. Jack Black, the actor. Not long ago, with only 2 hours' notice, we from a phone call from the Secret Service saying that Vice President Joe Biden wanted to have lunch at the famous Homegirl Cafe. So it was motorcades and entourage and selfies with Joe, you know. I wasn't in town. I was making my annual silent 8-day retreat, so I didn't know about it. And when I got home, one of the trainees, Louis Mora, was giving me the debrief. You know, he goes, while you were gone, we were visited by an MVP. I said, do you mean a VIP? Yeah, that one, VIP. He goes, damn, gee, imagine here at Homeboy Industries, we were visited by the Vice President of the United States of America, Mick Romney. And I swear to you, I would never have made that up. And I think we may actually add current affairs to our curriculum. But most famously of all, Diane Keaton showed up for lunch. She of Academy Award fame, Annie Hall, Godfather movies, big movie star. She's there with a regular who's there once a week. And so her waitress is Glenda. And Glenda's a big girl, been there, done that, tattooed. Felon, parolee, gang member, she has no clue who Diane Keaton is. And so she's taking her order, and Diane Keaton says, well, what do you recommend? And Glenda rattles off the 3 dishes she particularly likes. And then Diane Keaton says, well, I'll have that second one. That one sounds good. And then it's at that moment, for some reason, something dawns on Glenda. She looks at Diane Keaton, she says, wait a minute. I feel like I know you from somewhere. You know, like maybe we've met. And Diane Keaton decides to deflect it humbly. Oh, gosh, I don't know. I suppose I have one of those faces that people think they've seen before. And then Glenda goes, no, now I know. We were locked up together. Yeah, well, that just took my breath away when I heard it, and I don't believe we've had any further Diane Keaton sightings, now that I think of it. But suddenly, kinship so quickly. Oscar-winning actress, attitudinal waitress, exactly what God had in mind. And if you'll permit me. So Jesus says to the gathered, that you may be one. I suppose he could have said more about himself. But no, it's not self-referential. It's about us. It's about our union and our connection. All of us are called to be what Alice Miller, the late great child psychologist, called enlightened witnesses, people who through your kindness and tenderness and focused, attentive love, return people to themselves. At Homeboy, we're really quite allergic to the notion of holding the bar up and asking the homies to measure up. We just want to show up and hold the mirror up and tell people the truth. Knowing that your truth is my truth, and my truth is a gang member's truth, and it's all the same truth, and here's the truth. You are exactly what God had in mind when God made you. And then you watch folks on the margins as they become that truth, as they inhabit that truth. And no bullet can pierce it. No four prison walls can keep it out. And death can't touch it because it's huge. But part of our task at Homeboy, of course, is to reach in and to dismantle the messages of shame and disgrace that get in the way, that keep people from seeing their truth. For indeed it's true that the principal suffering of the poor throughout history is shame and disgrace. I would invite you to take a leisurely stroll through the Acts of the Apostles, and what you'll find there is not a quaint snapshot of life in the earliest Christian community. What you'll find instead is the measure of health in any community at all. Things will leap off the page if you read it that way. Things like, see how they love one another. That's a pretty good way to measure. There's nobody needy in this community. That's an excellent metric. But my favorite one is the oddest one, and it says simply, and awe came upon everyone. That the measure of our health may well reside in our ability to stand in awe at what the poor have to carry, rather than stand in judgment at how they carry it. So I was invited to speak to 600 social workers in Richmond, Virginia. And as I always do, I'll just say, oh, sure, you know, and I say yes, and I don't, as they say in Spanish, fijarme. I don't really read the not-so-small print. And I knew it was a conference, an all-day conference from 9 to 5, and I figure maybe I'll do the keynote, like here, the end or the beginning or lunchtime speaker. So I pull the letter out and to kind of see what it says, and oh my God, it's a gang-in service, 9 to 5. I am to be the only speaker at this thing. And I went, oh my God. So I call in two homies, Andre and Jose, and I sit them down, and I said, look, you're flying with me to Richmond, Virginia. I'd like you to get up and tell your stories. Take your time. Because we got a long-ass day to fill. So I never heard their stories, and Jose gets up, and he's about 25 years old at the time, gang member, tattooed, been to prison, felon. He was finishing up his 18 months with us, and he ended up as a very valued member of our substance abuse team, a man really solid in his own recovery, now helping younger homies with their addiction issues. A man who, you know, aside from being in prison for a stretch, he was had a long stretch as a homeless man, even longer stretch as a heroin addict. So he gets up in front of the 600 social workers, and he begins in kind of a little offhanded way. I guess you could say my mom and me, we didn't get along so good. I think I was six when she looked at me and she said, "Why don't you just kill yourself? You're such a burden to me." Well, 600 social workers audibly gasp. And he says, "It sounds way worse in Spanish." And we got whiplash going from gasp to laugh, you know. "I think I was 9, he says, "when my mom drove me down to the deepest part of Baja California. And she walks me up to an orphanage. She knocks on the door. The guy comes to the door and she says, 'I found this kid.' And she left me there for 90 days until my grandmother could get out of her where she had dumped me. And my grandmother came and rescued me. My mom beat me every single day of my elementary school years with things you could imagine and a lot of things you couldn't. Every day my back was bloodied and scarred. In fact, I had to wear 3 t-shirts to school every day. First t-shirt because the blood would seep through. Second t-shirt, you could still see it. Finally, the 3rd t-shirt, you couldn't see any blood. Kids at school, they'd make fun of me. They'd say, 'Hey, fool, it's 100 degrees. Why are you wearing 3 t-shirts?' Then he stopped speaking, overwhelmed with emotion, and he seemed to be staring at a piece of his story that only he could see. And when he could regain his speech, he said through his tears, 'I wore 3 t-shirts well into my adult years because I was ashamed of my wounds. I didn't want anybody to see them. But now I welcome my wounds. I run my fingers over my scars. My wounds are my friends. After all, how can I help heal the wounded if I don't welcome my own wounds?' And awe came upon everyone. The measure of our compassion lies not in our service of those on the margins, but only in our willingness to see ourselves in kinship with them. For the truth of the matter is this: if we don't welcome our own wounds, we will be tempted to despise the wounded." Everything depends on our diagnosis. Nobody in this room or outside of it has ever met a healthy treatment plan that was born of a bad one. Getting the diagnosis is always right and hugely essential. I continue to battle a little bit with leukemia and have to return every once in a while to for my spa days to take some treatments. Though the homies still come up to me and say, "I hear your cancer's in intermission." And they said, well, yeah, I apparently had stepped out to the lobby to buy popcorn. May the line be long. But I went to give blood once, and the guy who was taking my blood said, oh, you got to get to a doctor fast. So I did, and the doctor said I had mononucleosis, so, and I think we can acknowledge that there may well be a difference between leukemia and mono. So I was sort of untreated for a year, and because the diagnosis was bad, it puts you behind the eight ball. So suddenly I had to rush into chemotherapy, and so a bad diagnosis is never neutral. It always puts you behind the eight ball. We want to get this right. So there I am on the Dr. Phil show. I know, what was I thinking? But we thought we had talked him, his producers, off the ledge, you know, of which they wanted us to leap. And so there I am backstage, and I can hear Dr. Phil. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the executive director and founder of Homeboy Industries, Father Greg Boyle. So I walk out there, and there are bleachers, you know, with people packed in them. And they're clapping. And to my horror, there's Phil sitting on a stool in the middle of the stage. My empty stool awaits me. But on his side of the stage is a beautiful, gorgeous mahogany coffin sitting on one of those four-wheel dolly deals draped in velvet or something. On my side of the stage is a perfectly reconstructed jail cell with bars, bed, toilet, sink. They went to great expense for these two set pieces. I was the guest for the whole hour, and you already know where this is going to go. You know, the producers fly in three young males, African-American, Latino, and a white kid, all kids who were kind of gravitating perilously close to some kind of gang involvement. So they flew them from different parts of the country with their very distraught single mothers. And then they came out one at a time, and Phil would sort of grab the kid figuratively by the lapel. Don't you see where this choice is leading you? Death or prison. Finally, by the third kid, I said, Phil, how do I break this to you? You know, these kids don't need more information. They're not awaiting more data. They know this will lead to death or to prison. They don't care that it will. And that's the key diagnostic moment. Nobody in this room or outside of it has ever met a hopeful kid who joined a gang. Never happened. Not once. No exception. No kid is seeking anything when he joins a gang. Always fleeing something. No exceptions. And the profiles of kids who join gangs are the following. The largest group is the lethal absence of hope group, the despondent kid, the kid who cannot imagine a future. So he doesn't plan his future, he plans his funeral. The second group, the smaller profile, is the traumatized, damaged kid, the kid who can't see his way clear to transform his pain, so he keeps transmitting it. And then the third group, smaller, is the mentally ill kid. That's it. There are only three profiles. There aren't profiles of, you know, the kid who's looking for excitement. I was at a city recently, and the chief of police handed me one of those brochures you give to your parents. How do you tell if your kid is getting near joining a gang? And the number one reason why kids join gangs, excitement, the pamphlet said. Talk about a bad diagnosis. That's not even on my top 100 reasons. It's so important to get this one right, because gangs are the places kids go when they've encountered their life as a misery. And who doesn't know by now that misery loves company? That if a kid can't imagine his future, his present isn't very compelling. And if your present doesn't compel you, then you won't care whether you inflict harm, and you won't care whether you duck to get out of harm's way. If we believed that as a diagnosis, what would we do? We'd infuse hope to kids for whom hope is foreign. We would heal the traumatized kid. We would deliver mental health services in a timely and culturally appropriate way. That's what we would do. And it would work. At Homeboy Industries, we only hire gang members who have records of serious and violent offending, because we're reverse cherry pickers. We don't want to work with the most likely to succeed. They don't need us. We want to work with folks who need healing. If love is the answer, community is the context. But tenderness is the methodology. That's the most foreign thing there is. If love doesn't become tenderness, it stays in the air, in your head, in your heart. But if it becomes tenderness, it's the connective tissue that joins you in relationship to the other, so that the folk on the margin can inhabit his or her dignity and feel their sovereignty in the world. An outreach gang worker asked me in Houston recently, how do you reach them? I said, for starters, stop trying to reach them. Can you be reached by them? That's the only thing that counts. Watch what happens once you allow yourself to be reached by them. Can you receive them? Because the only way they'll know they're valuable is by you valuing them. And I stand in awe at David and Reuben here, because the day won't ever come when I have more courage or I am more noble or I am closer to God than you. A reporter on PBS ended an interview by saying, how's it feel to have saved thousands and thousands of lives? And I said, I don't know what you're talking about. The only thing I know for sure is my life is saved every day by you. Let me end with this. It occurs to people, because I have a book called Tattoos on the Heart, it occurs to universities sometimes to force their students to read my book against their will. And I'm not complaining, but my alma mater, Gonzaga University in Spokane, did that, and so the freshmen had to read it before they came to school, and so they said, come and speak, can you bring two homies? And I always pick homies in the same way. I pick homies who are enemies, rivals, just so that they force them to share a hotel room together, just to mess with them. And I always pick homies who have never flown before, just for the thrill of seeing homies panicked in the sky. And so I picked Bobby, an African-American gang member who at the time worked in the bakery, and Mario, who at the time worked in our merchandise store. And I've done this hundreds and hundreds of times with men and women, and never in my life have I had anybody fly with me so terrified as this kid, Mario. I mean, my God, he was hyperventilating. And we hadn't even boarded the plane yet. So we were flying out of Burbank Airport, which, if you don't know, it's a smaller airport, and big bay windows, Southwest Airlines, big airplanes, but, you know, they don't have that hermetically sealed chute to get onto the plane. You have to walk out into the tarmac, climb the stairs, the front of the plane and the back of the plane. And so I'm sitting there with Mario, and our plane arrives. It's early morning. And I said, well, there's our plane. And I, oh my God, he may die, you know, before we climb up those stairs. And then I watch our flight attendants arrive. And two flight attendants, females, both have really large cups of Starbucks coffee. And the two of them are schlepping up the front steps to get on the plane. And Mario goes, when are we going to board the plane? And I go, well, as soon as they sober up the pilots. There they go now, you know. Maybe I shouldn't have said that. So I should tell you that Mario is about, in the history of our almost 30-year history, the most tattooed individual who's ever worked at Homeboy, which is really saying a lot. He's all sleeved out, neck blackened with the name of his gang, head shaved, covered in tattoos, forehead, cheeks, chin, all but a little area here, you know. And I had never been in public with him, and so we were walking through Burbank Airport, and people are like this, you know, and mothers are clutching their kids a little more closely, and I'm thinking, wow, if you were to go to Homeboy today, Mario now works behind the counter selling baked goods. If you went to Homeboy today and asked anybody, who's the kindest, most gentle soul here? They won't say me. They'll say Mario. He's so tender. He's so gentle. He's such a kind soul. Even for as terrified as he was on the plane, you know, and the flight attendant handed him peanuts, you know, he didn't just take them and he didn't just thank her. He grabs her hand and looks her in the eye and, thank you so much. You know, just way over the top. So so we get to Gonzaga, and this happens only all the time. You know, they go, you've got the big talk Tuesday night, 2,000 people, this huge venue. What they don't tell you is they have 94 other talks planned, you know, this class, this lunch, this meeting, because they want to get their money's worth. So I tell Mario and Bobby, I said, look, I'm not speaking in any of these venues. You are. I'm going to sit in the back of the classroom, so I want you to get up and tell your stories. And they're terrified, especially Mario's most nervous, but they get up and they do a good job. Stories of terror and torture and abuse of every single imaginable kind. Stories of neglect and abandonment. And honest to God, if their stories had been flames, you'd have to keep your distance. Otherwise, you'd get scorched. So the nighttime talk comes, and it's 2,000 people, standing room only, people sitting on the floor. And I said, look, I want you guys to get up before me, do a little five-minute snapshot, so that you can come up after my talk, and I'll include you in the question and answer. And they were really nervous because of the number of people. But they got up, and they did a good job. And then I finished my 45 minutes or whatever, and I call them up, and they're standing on either side. Yeah, well, let's open this up now. Yes, ma'am. And a woman stands, and she goes, yeah, I got a question. It's for Mario. First question out the gate is for Mario. And he's just this tall, skinny drink of water, and he comes over, and he grabs the microphone. He's terrified, and he's trembling. Yes. And the woman says, well, you say you're a father, and you have a son and a daughter, and they're about to enter their teenage years. What wisdom do you impart to them? You know, what advice do you give them? And Mario closes his eyes and he grips the microphone. And I can feel standing next to him, there's a kind of a rising emotion, and he's just trembling. And he's getting a hernia trying to come up with the right answer. And when suddenly he blurts out, as soon as he says those two words, he retreats back into his closed-eyed sanctuary, and he's trembling all the more, and he's clutching the microphone even more. And I can feel the emotion rising, but he wants to get this sentence out. I just don't want my kids to turn out to be like me. And there's silence. Until the woman who asked the question stands, and now it's her turn to cry. And she looks at Mario and she says, why wouldn't you want your kids to turn out to be like you? You are loving. You are kind. You are gentle. You are wise. I hope your kids turn out to be like you. And 2,000 total perfect strangers stand. And they will not stop clapping. And all Mario can do is hold his face in his hands, so overwhelmed that this room full of strangers had returned him to himself. And every member of that audience also returned himself. to themselves, which shouldn't surprise us because it's mutual, that you may be one. This conference is not the place you've come to. It's only always been the place you go from. And you stand at the margins and you cease to care whether anybody accuses you of wasting your time. For the prophet Jeremiah writes, in this place of which you say it is a waste, there will be heard again the voice of mirth and the voice of gladness, the voices of those who sing. And you go from this place so that those voices can be heard. For the vision still has its time, presses on to fulfillment, and it will not disappoint. And if it delays, we can wait for it. Thank you all very much.